Here we are for Summerfest. Hey! So it's a beautiful evening for, I think, a remarkable program. It's a very unusual program. And I have to say, when I have to sit down and think, okay, what is the story of this program? What do I think might be helpful? The more composers, the more of a time frame that you're looking at, and the more styles, the more difficult, right, to come up with something coherent that lasts about 30 minutes. You can hopscotch across. So I decided, well, one thing is to look, you know, for the programming and for La Jolla Music Society, they come up with an idea. They feel that in some way it offers an anchor to the program that you're going to see. So it's counterpoint. It's a word that maybe you've heard of, have some idea. How many of you maybe have, who's taken music theory here? Okay, there's a few. There's, all right, good, we'll be good. So we'll get, but there are many who have not, and even those, if you say, okay, so explain counterpoint, it's a little tricky. So I thought I would think about it, because it is, in fact, a foundation. It's one of those ideas that sometimes the more romantic program audiences don't want to know about, because there is an idea that the composer gets dreamy, you know, inspiration, and then settles it out and it comes out beautifully. The idea of technique, of actual architecture and rules and regulations and process can be, it's like, no, art just doesn't happen that way. But in fact, music is very technical in many ways. The music that we're hearing mostly in this concert hall for this series, for the Summerfest, and for the various classical music series, relies on certain rules and regulations that you can then break, adapt, fight against, use, all of those, but you can't. So Debussy is very famous for having said, I don't need any of these fugues. Nobody, inspiration, pleasure is the law. And then someone said, but wait, didn't you go to the conservatoire? Didn't you study? Yes, okay, I did. So I studied fugues and I don't need to write them anymore. And that is, in a sense, is that you don't set out to say, now I'm going to make a counterpoint composition necessarily, but counterpoint is part of it. So I wanted to look at some of the things, you know, at the very kind of bottom level, from the Latin contrapunctus, from contrapunctum, against the point, against the note, in this sense. So I've given you, this is what we actually call a kind of first species counterpoint, a very early brand, kind of the simplest, although simple can be misleading. There are rules for how these would be put together, and you can see this is note against note. And that's what you'll find if you look in some of the music dictionaries. Counterpoint will say a term first used in the 14th century. So even though you're seeing something, the earliest is from the Baroque period, starting in the 17th century. This is a very old idea for Western classical music. It actually is very scientific in a sense. There's a way to do music correctly. So it said this combination of simultaneously sounding musical lines according to a system of rules. And when it says musical lines, it's actually not talking about a melody with the idea of chords. It's thinking very much, instead, this horizontal dimension. I was looking at a person who does like music theory videos. I was trying to find, was there one that was good? And I will say he gave a great analogy of, let's say, of ballroom dancing. You cannot just go off on your own when you are in a partner dance. Each of you can stylize, and you have your role. But what you do must somehow relate to what they do. I started taking a Lindy Hop course, and I'm learning all about what it is to be a follow as opposed to a lead. And what it means that if I'm stepping this way, my partner will put their hand in telling me which way we're going to go. I have choices then as we begin to stylize, but there's still a rule, in a sense, to something that looks quite improvised in the action of it. So I just wanted to show you, this is what every music student, not just composers, but if you go and you get a music degree, you're probably going to have to learn something about this species counterpoint. This is early stuff where they're thinking, how do those dance partners work? And they say, well, you can move together. You can have a similar motion. You can go in contrary motion. And oblique means somebody stands still while the other person moves. These were the choices. And then they began to play with that. So you would go through just to show you some of the ways that this works. So one note against one note. Not very interesting, but that's like the skeleton of the creation. And then they begin to have you play with different ideas. So you would come to second species and they would bring it here. Two notes against one note, right? So they begin to think of what that will feel like as you're listening. Oop, that's not what I wanted to do. That's what happens when you're like trying to look this way. There we go. And then they begin to play more. They give you examples of one could be on the top. They play with that a little bit. Third species, four notes against one note. This is going to feel a little bit more like music to you. A different way that the notes are relating, not just speed, but two notes against one, but involving suspension. Those little ties that you see between the notes means they're not going to move quite at the same time. And then they move finally to fifth species, where, as they say, all of the elements come together. Now you're starting to really compose. So that's like the bare bones when students are starting to understand how do we relate independent parts. Again, not a subordinate, not a kind of harmonic chord with a predominating melody, but interacting lines, each of which have a certain predominance in themselves. This was very common in the Renaissance. And you began to get not only these independent, beautiful lines, but also a sense of maybe you could up the ante by making it imitative, meaning everybody's going to come in with the same line, but at different times, which means you need to have it line up so it sounds like they know what they're doing. So this is Tomás Luis de Vitoria, Magnum Mysterium. Let you listen to a moment. Second line. So they've done the same line at different pitch levels. The bass. Counterpoint. All those little simple exercises I showed, now you see what happens when somebody really knows what to do with it. Interestingly, the first piece that we have today, which is written sometime in the first part of the 17th century, was not as interested in this kind of counterpoint. The early 17th century, besides being an amazing time for scientific inquiry and many other developments, technological developments in the world, was a time where composers began to say, well, what if we want to break some of these rules? We will allow more dissonance. We will allow for more sounds that are a little crunchy. And we'll allow them to arrive on the strong beat, not always on the weak beat. What if we start playing with that? It was also the time that opera came to be. And during this time, you have our first Giovanni Valentini. How many of people have heard any Giovanni Valentini? If anybody had, I should have been very surprised. So one of the many Italian composers of this time, because really the Italians, the last time they had the upper hand in Western classical music was during the Baroque period, except for opera. And Valentini was part of this group, born near Venice, if not in Venice. We have a kind of general, so at the end of the 16th century, really going into this experimental time of the late 16th, early 17th century in Italy for music. He was known as a composer, a keyboard player, and a poet. And I think that this probably made the program because our bass player today is part of the group Acronym, which is an early music band, where he plays violone, the large older double bass, and also viola da gamba. So he's playing today, and I think this came through. Valentini was described as a Venetian of the famous school of the Gabrielli's. Now, all that meant is he would have known a lot about the style of music that happened here. In fact, a lot of his early stuff was religious, sacred music. He would have been at St. Mark's. He would have known about the style that really was part and parcel of the musical life of Venice in this this basilica because of its very interesting interior. And let me just show you again. You can kind of hear some of the sounds of what Gabrielli would have written. So these there were two of them, Giovanni and Andrea, both working in Venice. And this is the sound. This is the internal part. You heard this kind of back and forth between the two voices, and pretty soon you'll get chorus. This was called cori spezzati, divided chorus, with the idea that at St. Mark's you had all those lofts, so that choruses could actually be little groups of instruments could be in the different lofts playing, and you would hear it in kind of stereophonic sound. So they took advantage of the architecture to create that. I say that because when you listen to the sonata from tonight, there is going to be some of that sense of the two kind of solo voices going, imitating and singing together, but also they could potentially divide it, even though it's not a religious piece. I wanted to say it was typical of his time that he managed, this was a very upwardly mobile composer, and I got so into looking him, you know, for his history that I had to share some. He was went from Venice. Typical, many Italians went north to find jobs because everybody thought the Italians were the best musicians. My Italian husband from Italy would be absolutely, well, of course. Ma certo, I mean, si fa così. Italiani sono I migliori. So we have Venice. He gets up. He's partly the organist to the King Zygmunt, great name, III of Poland. Then finds his way to Graz, where he falls in with Archduke Ferdinand, who then becomes Holy Roman Emperor. And he ends up as the music director, basically, of the empire in Austria. So the sad, there's a good and bad about that. Very cool, he had a great life. Not so happy is that history's like that. People disappear. Incredibly famous. Incredibly successful in his lifetime, but we rely on pieces too often. We want the artwork. And the artist is sometimes, unless they're lionized in our history books, are forgotten. So that's why I spent a little bit more time with him. He also did something amazing. He introduced opera to Vienna. He was part of that. But he wrote this sonata in harmonica. I was reading, I read this, in 1617, Urban Vielhauer von Hohenhau, court organist to Archduke Karl, Bishop Breslau, praised Valentini as a virtuoso performer in connection with an enharmonic clavicembalum universale sui perfectum. So he was a perfect on the enharmonic universal keyboard, which had 77 keys for 4 octaves. Right? So instead of what we'd be looking at 48, it had splashed out to 77. Keep that in mind. We'll come back to this. This is in the early 17th century. So let's talk about 2 other theory ideas that go kind of hand in hand with the musical style. One is chromaticism. Chromatic, diatonic, and harmonic, these are all ancient Greek terms used in music. So we've borrowed things from that culture. For mostly, chromaticism means this. In music, the use of notes foreign to the mode or diatonic scale upon which a composition is based. This means if it's in the key of C, you have a scale associated with that, and you only use those notes. If you add something new, you add color, chroma, to that key. So it's something that way. So that's one thing. The second word, enharmonic. A couple things, and they both relate to what you hear tonight. Relating to notes that are the same in pitch in modern tuning, though bearing different names. And I think this is closed, so I can't really, but on a piano, I'll have an example. You'll be able to see. If you look at B, you could call that C flat. C lowered. So those are enharmonic spellings, depending. The other thing, and this is interesting, and this is where you get into why Valentini's thing is called enharmonica, because you could have intervals smaller than a semitone. The notes between, and again, I think this is probably closed up. I don't know, but I can open it. So look at this. So, let's go a little lower in case it's not carrying. Those are all semitones, half steps. Equal. Every pitch on the piano is equal distance. And that distance is called a half step or a semitone. This is saying less than a semitone. What we're talking about is microtones in the Baroque period. Somebody experimenting with smaller distances between the notes. So what this means for this enharmonica is, I'll play some of it and you'll hear. Here's an example. This is a G minor scale. You don't have to read music. You can see that the letters go up. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. G to G, there's your key. And it tells you, oh, but this is G minor, so we've flatted the B. That's what that is. We've flatted the E flat. And in what's the natural minor, we've kept everything else the same. We can add a chromatic element, which actually is something added to the scale to make a harmonic, which is a leading tone. I know, this don't glaze over yet. There's no test. No test. I want to show you the comparison because you're going to hear it. So you can say, wow, we learned a lot of, I generally do not do this, but it's called point counterpoint. So now you're like, I got it. So what happens here? We can do the same thing. We're going to sharpen those. These are the 2 keys that you hear at the beginning of the sonata in harmonica. And it's going to grate. It's going to seem a little strange, not dissonant, not where you go, ooh, I don't like that. But like, how did we, wait, and we'll go back and forth. And some of that is caused by these issues. The fact is there are some shared notes But then there are several that are just a half step apart. So when you have this sound, example, it's not, doesn't seem, but it's not the kind of thing that you would have heard. So this idea is he's playing not with the typical, oh, the key is in G minor, even though that's what it says. Because the one thing you would not have, looking back here, in G minor, that B flat is essential. It's what makes the minor of G sound. So if you suddenly do this, and you start on a B major, that's the part where we're getting. So enharmonic isn't really the correct, necessarily, this was Romantics putting it on, but it's telling you, it's almost like you're switching between a pivot between two worlds that come together, not with a transition, but right up against each other. So that's a lot of theory, and now we'll make it a little bit easier. Let's go over here. Let's go to Haydn. You're like, oh, thank God, she's gone to Haydn. Woo! But this brings us back to counterpoint. So Haydn, this we think this is Haydn. This is a painting by a guy named Schmidt. Apparently, we would have seen Haydn there in the green jacket, the first violin. We would have had von Hall on cello. We would have had the noble Dieters von Dietersdorf. And that is his name. And he's playing second violin. And supposedly there, peeking over with the viola, is a young Mozart. The thing about chamber music, and the reason that it always works so well, is that it's automatically a conversation between those independent lines. You automatically have that. So it lends itself to counterpoint. But Haydn really wanted to show, he was very intent on making this group, the Opus 20, about counterpoint. It's at least half of it. Just a quick thing, if you look here, you don't need to know that, but there's a whole bunch of this is all the Opus 20 in order of their composition, and I've let you see number 5, which we'll hear, Fuga a due soggetti, fugue with two subjects. Fugue is a contrapuntal form. Fugue with three, and with four. So half of them have fugues at the end. Why? Because someone insulted him from Germany, a German against an Austrian. It's been a long history there. And said, the man has some nice ideas, but he's too flippant and has no mastery over counterpoint. So he showed them by that. So when you're listening, I want you to think as we get to the fugue finale, this is where you'll see that imitative counterpoint again. The same melody, only this time we have two of them. A long note one that looks like what we saw with Species, and this shorter, more active sound. Hi. So that was his way of showing his ability. A partner piece to this is another classical, is Mozart's Fantasia. This one, we're going to hear it in Busoni in an early 20th century arrangement for two pianos. But it was originally written for mechanical organ, actually sometimes called a mechanical clock, because it's a clock with an organ. And I wanted to show you just a little bit of this. This is from the Leeds Museum. It's the George Pike clock. This one is pretty amazing.
One of the 8 tunes which we can hear on the organ when it plays is actually composed by Haydn, and it's known as the Call of the Quail.
Thank you.
around three of these different things. This one that you'll hear tonight is 12 minutes long, so that's a lot of music. It paid, so that was useful, but he really hated the sound of this. And he imagined instead his idea, and many organists love this piece, and they do it even though it's very hard to play because it wasn't actually written for a human organist. This is what they want to hear. This is what Mozart wanted to hear. After that kind of fantastic opening that feels very improvisatory, get the second, a fugue, each of those little parts coming through. So even in a piece for mechanical organ, that Mozart went back to counterpoint. So even if it's called fantasy, so he had to know all of that. Everybody had to. Beethoven loved this piece. There's a great program notes that you'll be able to read. Now, I'm purposely skipping over the Elgar because, frankly, I think that's a stretch to put it in the point counterpoint. There's a fantastic program note that you can look at. It's interesting also because Elgar did not write a lot of chamber music. And this came precisely at a moment at the end of World War I when many composers began to look back at smaller genres in a kind of neoclassic move. So you can enjoy that. And I just want to talk for a moment about Steve Reich before we leave. This New York counterpoint, actually an older piece, but we're having a premiere of a multimedia presentation. And this makes absolute sense. With Reich, with Glass, with a lot of the composers writing at that time because they really did think theatrically and programmatically. In this case, this was actually the first recording. What the composer said, that he was thinking in pulsations, which is what his brand and what he made is different pulsations. So instead of a counterpoint of kind of lines, it's a counterpoint of rhythm. So instead of a melodic tones, that can happen, and but it's little tiny bits of tone and rhythmic ideas that go with them that are interlocked in a contrapuntal way. So he wrote a few of these. He wrote a Vermont counterpoint and different, so he had this. But he said that he had started this idea with things like phasing. So if you don't know anything, I'm gonna give you just two quick sneak peeks before we close of what was in the back of Reich's head when he was working in the 80s. So these are earlier pieces coming from the 70s, late 60s and 70s. This is violin phase. It's very difficult. So here are the ideas. And what the violin has to do is they're playing and then they have to slowly go out of sync. So I remember this because my son, who's here, he had to do a musical report, and he's like, I didn't pick a composer. And I said, your mom's a musicologist. I can find you a composer that nobody else has chosen. So he did Reich, and he was very fascinated with this idea of phasing. So here's the sound of it. So this is synchronized, takes a minute. Pattern of almost like something that starts here and then it crystallizes, right? It comes out. Reich also talked about things where he takes different types of pulsations, which you can hear, just one second, let me get this here. You can hear in a piece like this, which is his mallet quartet. Let's listen to this real quick, you can hear. Exactly. We can feel different levels, just like that species counterpoint. We can feel different levels. There's kind of that boom, 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 right? The slow, and then this one, and then that's what he wants you to feel, is the counterpoint of those rhythmic levels coming together with little bits of melody that you can hear, but it's really the feeling of what we call in music texture. You're feeling a contrapuntal texture. So I hope now that this sets you up to really enjoy this without it saying, oh yeah, it was named something weird. You'll go, yeah, counterpoint. It's where all the cool kids hang out. So thank you and enjoy the program.